Hello, gang. How is everybody this week? You are up front with Frank Rothstein on the City World Radio Network. We are broadcasting, as always, 120 feet in the air, the sixth floor. Sitting with me, as always, a woman who just came back from vacation and did not bring me a T-shirt. It is the well-rested Jade Zabrick. Hello, Jade. We are also broadcasting on Jade's thing. We are on Sky's Crescent Radio, which appears on every .com you can imagine, which means we are on Spreaker.com. Just keep forward slashing Sky's Crescent Radio. We are on iHeartRadio.com. We are on Radiotomy. We are on, but most important, go to Sky'sCrescentRadio.com, and you can find everything, everyone there. And that's where we are. So we have a good week this week, chock full of news. Not necessarily all of it good, but chock full of news. And believe me, there are some dumbass people out there. Here it is. We got to start off with the boss, the guy who gets the big money. Our president, Donald Trump, backs a push for Bible classes in schools. Yep. I am not kidding you. And it says, President Trump appeared to endorse efforts by legislators in several states to allow public schools to offer Bible classes. Excuse me. Numerous states introducing Bible literacy classes. I could use that, literacy. Giving students the option of studying the Bible. Starting to make a turn back. Great, he says. Monday morning, after Fox and Friends ran a segment on the topic, that was his comment. Great. Christian lawmakers and six Republican-controlled state legislatures across the country are pushing for a bill that would allow public schools to offer elective classes on the New and Old Testament. So now you know what's going on, and this is, of course, is, let's see, Alabama, Iowa, West Virginia have also considered Bible literacy bills, but all of the measures were voted down. That's according to Fox News. But in Kentucky, Republican Governor Matt Bevin signed legislation in 2017 to allow public school students to take Bible and Hebrew scriptures classes. A year ago, in January 18, the ACLU of Kentucky expressed concern to the Kentucky Board of Education after an Open Record Act investigation found that many courses violated constitutional requirements. All right, we all know what that means. Yes, of course, we're supposed to understand the difference between church and state, separating church and state. But somehow I get the impression that this president needs an influx of new supporters. So this is the way he's going. Why should I not think any other way? That's just what I think. Not all my news stories are fun stories this week, but I cannot think of anything more appropriate than this little tidbit, which I got it from the New York Post, but this has been studied many times in the last 40 years, and this says millennial men are getting dumber by the year. This was published, actually, on June 12th, but I saw it, so I didn't talk about it. Okay. And it says, with their shirtless bathroom selfies and plates of $18 avocado toast, it's hard to argue millennial men are getting dumber by the year, and even science agrees. The IQ sources of young men have plunged below previous generation for the first time in nearly a century, and that's a new study claiming that. Research examined the intelligence levels of more than 730,000 young Norwegian men and found their scores dropped roughly 8 points between 1970 and 2009, according to a report published Monday in the journal PNAS, which I don't know what that stands for, but okay. Let's see. The results are impressive and pretty worrying. And that's from the University of Edinburgh, psychologist Stuart Ritchie. He told that to the Times of London. For the past 90 years, the IQ levels of young people were believed to have steadily increased by 3 points per generation in a phenomenon dubbed the Flynn effect. But the selfie generation Empty-headedness may be linked to the way math and language are now taught. Okay. And that along with more time spent on TV and computers. Well, why not? Do you know what happened in the last 3-4 decades? Technology. Nobody has to think anymore. Technology. People don't have to do anything. Everything you want is at the click of a button. Every app, every little something is on the click of a button. Hello, everybody on LiveMe. I am broadcasting on the internet again. I am on LiveMe. I am on Facebook. If you go to the Upfront with Frank page, you'll find me there. Leave a comment. I'll see it. But this is true. This is not surprising, especially in the 1970s when technology began to take off. We may not have had computers as individuals, and cable TV wasn't really out yet. But as time went on and people started relying more and more on technology, yeah, I could see where the world got dumb. Yeah, I have no reason to doubt this. And do I see people getting... I mean, I would not swear that people are losing IQ points. I will go with people are losing... This is based on millennial men, but I'll use this for everybody. People are relying more on technology to tell them what they need to do. People are not thinking anymore. As I was mentioned a while ago, I was listening to an interview by a guy named Mike Rowe. He hosted that show, Dirty Jobs. And he did a segment on safety third. And an example, the safety is not the most important thing, and people don't think about it as much. Matter of fact, he updated it to safety is not my concern. Safety is your concern. And he used the example of people no longer look both ways when they cross the street. They see the little sign. They're busy with their phones. They see the little sign flicker, and they start walking. But people don't really look both ways anymore. They're reliant on technology. They're not even responsible for their own safety. And I cannot begin to tell you how many arms I have grabbed as they're walking off the curb looking at their phone. And, yeah, I could believe it. For all the people who are reliant on every last thing on the internet, every last thing has to be built around their cell phone or their laptop or whatever they got with them. It really is not helping. Matter of fact, you've heard me say before, anything you can create, the internet will destroy. And I guess eventually it will destroy us one way or another. With that story... Let me go to another story, because this came from the BBC. Hello, all. I'm looking at Live Me. I'm seeing who's out here. I'm hitting my invite button. Yeah, I'm trying to balance a group of people. One second. Here we go. Screen time may harm toddlers. Okay. And this comes again from the BBC. It was published on a few days yesterday, the 28th. Letting a toddler spend lots of time using screens may delay their development of skills such as language, sociability, and that comes from a large Canadian study. The research was tracked over with nearly 2,500 two-year-olds, and the latest piece of evidence in the debate is how much screen time is safe for toddlers. In Canada and the U.S., experts say children should not use screens before they're at least 18 months old. Well, that is parents keeping their kids busy and they don't want to hear them crying. But the UK guidelines set no such limit. The Royal College of Pediatrics and Child Health says there is not enough evidence when you include the new study for a direct toxic effect. What does the new research find? Moms were surveyed between 2011 and 2016 about screen use and filled out questionnaires about their child's skills and development at age 2, 3, and 5. Screen time including watching TV programs, films, videos, gaming, and using a computer, tablet, or phone, or any other screen-based device. At age 2, the children were clocking in 17 hours per screen time per week. Wow. They don't want to hear the kids whine and cry. They're keeping them busy. Kids don't have the capacity to communicate at age two that well. So what are they doing? They're using their eyes. And the screen is not necessarily good for you, for a kid's eyes, a child's eyes. But I don't know. Was I learning to color in a book or just draw circles, scribbling on a piece of paper? But as time went on, I did things like a baby would. I'm sure I had little blocks and toys. And as time went on and I got old enough, I had an Erector set. You know, you get a screwdriver, little rods of screws, and you build whatever the hell you think of. But I know kids when I grew up, and kids in the generation after that, they weren't as reliant on technology. We had to go out. Matter of fact, I put up a picture on my Instagram page of a rubber ball, a Spalding rubber ball. Now, if you grew up in the New York area, New York, New Jersey, the five boroughs of New York, anywhere in the area, because everyone had their own accent and probably, I don't know how, but the Spalding ball, which is the inside of a tennis ball, became known as a Spalding. This was it, a Spalding. You had status as a kid if you had a brand new one. If you weren't one of the rich kids, you had a Penzi Pinky. But this one ball, even if you go into a store now, that little blue ball you see for $4, that ball could entertain 20 kids for hours and hours a day. There was no technology. Nobody had a computer. No one had a cell phone. It wasn't that way. And we learned how to deal with each other. And I've often said it is the responsibility of every little kid to get beaten up by a big kid. Why? Because it's what big kids do, and one day we will become the big kid. But basically, you learn social skills. Having a small child, a baby, sitting on a couch or on a floor just playing with a video game, they're not up, they're not moving, they're not learning, they're not getting their coordination. I can't believe that they're developing at the rate that they should. Well, maybe by the time they become 15, they'll become naturally, it'll become like second nature to them. I'm sure it will. But there are more important things that a baby could be doing than playing a video game. Okay, so now we got that story. We know what's happening to them. Why do I think it's dangerous? Because here comes, before I play the first song, from NBC News. What happens when a kid is so spoiled with their toys and their technology? Iowa teen found dead after running away over fight with parents over cell phone. And it says, well, there's no evidence at this time or information that indicates criminal activity is connected to this. And that is from the Marshalltown Police. Okay. 13-year-old Iowa boy who ran away from his parents' house after they took away his cell phone was found dead not far from the home. About a mile and a half away. Corey Brown of Marshalltown, Iowa, hadn't been seen since Tuesday night before searchers discovered his body in a secluded area. All right. Around 10:45 in the morning. 11:45 Eastern time. Okay, one second. Okay, here it is. I'm also playing with my computer here. The spot where he was found was less than a mile and a half away from the boy's home. And again, there's no sign of any kind of foul play of any kind. But it's freezing in Iowa. And this kid, who didn't know where to go, probably sat down somewhere, fell asleep, and froze to death. There's no cause of death exactly, but it says, weather complicated the search for Corey, as the high temperatures were never above 29 degrees while he was missing. The low, over those 4.5 days, bottomed at -9 degrees on Friday morning. More than 6 inches. Okay, so this kid froze to death. And this is, I'm not connecting parents giving their kid a phone to this kid dying, but it is like a drug. It is like a drug, technology. And there are even adults that are so hooked on it. Imagine with a kid who doesn't have the capacity to... Oh, well. Okay, so that's that. I'm going to shift gears for a few seconds. We're going to play... You got song number one there, Jade? Okay. This is a song I heard a while back. I have a lot of covers out tonight, but we're doing this one first. This is the... great blues singer. This is Charlie Musselwhite with River Hip Mama. Mm-hmm. Was Charlie Musselwhite with River Hip Mama. I always like that piece. Just to let everybody know this. Let's see. State of Washington has declared a state of emergency over a measles outbreak. Clark County's Governor Jay Inslee announced that the state of emergency, calling the situation an extreme public health risk that may spread over other counties. And that's because there were 30 confirmed cases in Clark County of measles. Measles. And a single known case in King County after a man in his 50s contracted measles and was hospitalized after a recent trip. Well, a man in his 50s should have gotten his inoculation way back when, but didn't, and got lucky that he didn't get measles. He didn't catch it. Babies, children, should be inoculated because they should be vaccinated. Why? Why should they have to get the measles? You don't have to anymore. It's not a necessity. Yes, there was a time you knew you were going to get the measles, mumps, and chickenpox, and anything else that may have come along, but you don't have to. Now there's a state of emergency in the state of Washington. Next up, okay, as I purposely read that people are getting stupid article, because people are getting stupid. Let's go to Japan. Japan's Supreme Court rules that transgender people still have to get sterilized before they can get their final conversion operation. Okay. Supreme Court of Japan has upheld a law which forces transgender people to get... Wait, let me flick this page. Of course, I didn't. Sterilized before they can legally change their gender. Excuse me. You can have your operation, but you have to go on record as being sterilized. Oh, man. The panel of four justices ruled unanimously on Thursday, January 24th, to reject an appeal filed by Takehito Usi, okay, a trans man who wants to change the gender on his official documents. An Australian outlet SBS News has reported this. Usi was trying to overturn Law 111, which requires any person seeking to change their legal gender to have no reproductive glands or reproductive glands that have permanently lost function. In other words, you got to get gutted. And that's what pretty much what this says. And, yeah, that is, wow. Sterilized. Haven't heard that expression in a long time. So pretty much like horses, you got to turn people into geldings. Yeah, okay, there's that one. And now for my favorite little mention of the week, some stories I can't get enough of. Oh, man, this is good. Okay, so now, does everyone out there know what conversion therapy is? Obviously, no one knows. Anyway, if you want to talk about this one, the number here is 646-690-2976. Sorry I didn't give it out earlier, but what the hell. 646-690-2976. Conversion therapy is for the narrow-minded, single-minded nitwits who are parents that do not like the idea that their children may be gay or have admitted to having thoughts of being gay, which means they're trying to nip it in the bud, so to say. And they send them to supposed therapists who try to, well, they call it therapy, I'll say, reprogram them to being heterosexual. Now, this is not just for boys. This is also for girls. And that's what the thought is. However, I love it when they're full of shit. Once prominent conversion therapist will now pursue life as a gay man. Described as the intellectual godfather of ex-gay therapy, Dave Matheson told NBC News he is now dating men. And this is from January 23rd. Oh, this is great. I hope he gets sued by everybody he ever thinks he treated. Dave Matheson, a once prominent Mormon conversion therapist who claims to have helped some gay men remain heterosexual in heterosexual marriages, is looking for a boyfriend. The revelation broke Sunday night after the LGBTQ nonprofit Truth Wins Out obtained a private Facebook post made by conversion therapist advocate Rich Weiler, which stated that Matheson says that living single celibate life just isn't feasible for him, so he's seeking a male partner. Let's see if I got this right. What is probably a man of some financial means, couldn't get a date, and since he's hopelessly single, he's going to turn over a new leaf. Okay, knock yourself out. There you go. I hope every one of his patients sue his ass off. I hope he's full of shit. I don't know what this guy is, but anyone who's going to try to brainwash somebody into some other way of living, to me, deserves whatever they get, and I hope for him it's thousands and thousands of lawsuits. Done. Let's play another song. Okay. This is good. No. I know which song I'm going to play. Not that it has to do with anything bad. Of course, it's a great song. However, I love the title, and it seems to fit. You have song number three. Only because Bohemian Rhapsody is doing so well at the box office and probably at the Academy Awards coming up. Freddie Mercury was, of course, a brilliant singer. He sang with opera stars. He sang with everybody. And he is really regarded as one of the greatest singers ever. But people know his songs, even though he's covered many great songs. Along the way, he covered a song by The Platters from 1955. And again, are you starting at 8 seconds? Okay. Got to make sure. Anyway, I always love this version of it. When you punch it up on Wikipedia, after they put up the original version by The Platters, the next version is Freddie Mercury making it his own. This is The Great Pretender.
Oh, yes, I'm the
Okay, so that was Freddie Mercury. He went way too soon, but he was something else. Now for this week, and maybe this week only, maybe I'll do this once in a while, I'm calling it the Florida Beat, because they're dumb down there. I mean, this whole theme of tonight, most of the stories, is pretty much people doing some dumb shit. So let's see what happens in Florida. And the headline is, this is from local10.com, of course, Florida man drove his Ferrari off a dock into the ocean. Let's see why he did this. Let's see. From Palm Beach. Police say a man purposely drove his Ferrari at top speed off of a dock and into the Palm Beach Inlet last month. And it says, although the reason has yet to be divulged, James Mucchiaccio, 48 years old, drove his luxury sports car off the dock around 7 a.m. on December 26th. WPTV reports that the Ferrari floated nearly 50 feet before it sank to the bottom of the inlet. Divers were able to use airbags to bring the car to the surface and float it to shore. Palm Beach Fire Rescue says alcohol and drugs were not involved in the incident. And Mucchiaccio, well, he was arrested. Wait, my computer's dying here during... my computer's giving me a hard time. See, the stories are so stupid that my computer's giving me a hard time. But either way, so then you have a guy who went into a fast food place. Okay, wait, I'm doing this. Okay. Another Florida man learned the hard way. This is from local10.com. That when he thought he was stealing opioids, he was stealing laxatives instead. Yes, that is true. He was stealing laxatives instead. I'm sure he was on the run when the runs hit him. Sorry, I had to try to make something out of that. But yeah, he got it. And I'm having some trouble here with this computer, so I cannot simply... Oh, here it is. I can do this. Here we go. What's this idiot's name? Florida man thought he was being smart. Okay, there you go. And that's pretty much... Oh, man, I'm sorry. My computer's giving me a hard time here. I don't know why, but it's doing it. Ruining my segment. Oh, well, the hell with it. Let's play one more song. That way I can sit here and bang on my computer. Which song did we... Okay. Sunday night, I went to go see my favorite singer, Raul Malo. We all know that. But even he covers songs every now and again. And between his runs with the Mavericks, he had a great solo career. And one of his albums, After Hours, he included a Buck Owens song. Man who really wrote it was Buck Owens. Most people attribute this song to Ray Charles, but really it was Buck Owens who did it. And Raul Malo covered it. And this is Crying Time.
Oh, it's crying time again. You're gonna leave me. I can see that far away look in your eyes. I can tell by the way you hold me, darling, that it won't be long before it's crying time. Say that absence makes a heart grow fonder, and that tears are only rain to make love grow. Well, my love for you could never grow no stronger if I live to be you love better. That's the way it's happened every time before. And as sure as the sun comes up tomorrow, crying time will start when you walk out that door. Oh, it's crying time again. You're gonna leave me. I can see that far away look in your eye. I can tell by the way you hold me, darling, that it won't be long before it's crying time. I can tell by the way you hold me, darling, that it won't be long before it's crying time.
So as all of my technology for the night has failed me, let me do things the way I brag it off. I can just wing it and talk to you like anything else. Computers actually distract me here. I'm using my cell phone, I'm using my laptop, and I have a little tablet I'm trying to play with. Let us just sit here and talk. Okay. One of the stories I noticed recently, and going back to the overuse of technology is, and this comes from ABC7 Eyewitness News, our local news. Okay. Americans aren't having enough babies to repopulate, and that comes from the CDC. This was published January 23rd. Again, I don't have access to news outlets as I'm sitting here, so a lot of times the stories I read come out just after I leave the studio, so I save them. This is according to a new CDC report found in 2017. Birth rates fell 16% below the level needed to repopulate the United States. According to researchers, the cost of raising kids and financial pressures on American households could be playing a factor in the decision to have less children. The report finds South Dakota and Utah were the only states that can replace its population, while Washington, D.C. had the lowest total fertility rate. CDC researchers found fertility rates among white women were consistently below the level for replacement in every state. Okay. Hispanic women, meanwhile, hit the replacement level in 29 states. Black women were able to reach the replacement level in 12 states. Okay. I'll get to the word white in a second. The report was based on a 2017 birth certificate data search. Okay. White. What all this is saying is that white people aren't having babies. That's what it's saying. Well, they're all sitting on their computers. They can't have any kids now, can we? Plus, just by visual observation, I don't even see people holding hands anymore, much less wanting to have a kid. Although a friend of mine is pregnant, but by and large, it is expensive to raise a kid, especially if you have to buy your three-year-old a $1,000 cell phone. But there is a lot going on in raising a kid. It's a fortune of money. And half the time they turn out no damn good anyway, but that's another story. But yeah, if the population is not repopulating itself at a decent enough rate, an acceptable rate, and you have the existing population getting older because of advancements in technology and medicine, you will at some point in time have an old, worn-out population because there's not enough kids to replace. And then that's the idea of what they're saying here. As people die out, there will be no one to replace them. Well, fewer. But then again, it all balances out because if you remember a while back, they were worried that will the planet be able to sustain us with all the people and all the food and the rainforests are going. So somehow, we will be fine. That is what I'm thinking. And I always go back to a bit I played a few weeks ago, of George Carlin on Saving the Planet. And it was this one line that he was talking about how the planet's going to be okay. He says, the planet's not going anywhere. We are. And do I see that? Can I understand that people are not having children because of expenses? Yeah. If everyone thinks that the kids have to go to the most exclusive private school, if you now have to interview for a kindergarten class before your child's even born, if they have to be interviewed for a nursery school, if rents, if your housing costs what it costs. Yeah, I could see that also. So, yeah, there you go. However, two kids, well, it's another story, on another story. So, yeah, everybody, get busy, please, all right? We don't want to run out of supply, so to say. What's going on over here now before I start playing some music? Let me see. From the Washington Post. This is actually going back. I just saw it. This goes back a few years. But I saw it and I liked it and I laughed at it and whatever. It says, teens think up clever condoms that would change colors to indicate STDs and its exposure. Condoms that will change colors when it comes into contact with sexually transmitted diseases. I think that's brilliant. I think it's very clever of the kids. I hope they get patents and get rich for whenever a big drug company wants to steal the idea. Except for one thing. Too late. I don't know of anyone that is that young that is going to use a color-changing condom that is going to check immediately to see if anything's wrong. I don't know too many men who are of adult age that they're going to sit there and check. Too late. But anyway, this is... It's too late. Well, this changes... This changes colors and it indicates sexually transmitted exposure. You may find out after you're done that... There's no alarm that goes off, no. And guys, young, especially... It doesn't say how long it takes. It was still in developing, but it doesn't say how long it takes. But I don't know too many 20-year-olds who are going to say, just a second. You're a girl, yeah.
Well,
but
I feel like this is probably for girls more than guys.
I would hope, but you can... So would girls. Women aren't perfect.
The condoms are for boys.
The condoms are for boys. They're sexual intercourse with women. The guys are already, hate to say it, gang, the guys are already covered up. It's going to react to the fluid inside of women. That's great. But unless you're going to take, there you go, to what it detects. But when the lights are off, no one's checking. And if it rips... Too late. So.
What I'm saying is, if I was going to spend money on this, I would wait the extra 20 minutes.
Yeah, but drunk guys don't think alone. Guys are stupid. I got to tell you.
As a female, I would make that drunk guy wait. And if he doesn't want to wait, then he can...
Maybe, but the only way... There's only one way to find out.
I still think this is good, and I still don't know why you say it's too late. That's what I'm saying.
Well, the idea too late of, by the time you realize that it's reacting, it could be too late. If the condom rips, if something goes on, it could be too late for both parties. It's only useful if someone checks in the middle of intercourse.
If you're going to trouble in buying this thing, then you would wait.
People buy things on novelties all the time. People are dumb. That's true. That's what I would say.
How much are these?
I have no idea.
Like, I think that's a great idea.
It's a great idea if people use it responsibly and effectively.
Like
yes.
Condoms.
Yes. Like condoms. Yes. But if you're looking to find out what's going on, then you should be aware then the lights cannot be totally off unless they glow in the dark, and someone has to check to see what's going on. That way, one or the other can say, that's that. Stop.
I feel like as a woman, I would get this just... I mean, you only need it for the first time you're having sex with someone.
Yeah.
After that, you know...
But the condom itself says he's already covered up. He's wearing the condom. That's the idea. This lets you know if there's... This isn't to find out what a guy has. This is to find out what a girl has.
I'm the girl. I would already... I need to know what the guy has. I know what I have.
That's true. But the only way...
This is for girls. This is great.
This is for girls. This is to protect everyone, of course. But if a man is wearing... If a boy or a man is wearing the condom, the idea is protection is being worn. Yeah, like sex, if you don't want to get pregnant, protection, anything can happen. That's right.
Also, a really cheap STD test.
It is. Yes, it is.
You don't even have to go to the clinic anymore. You just put a condom on.
That's true. Listen, if this thing glows in the dark to a certain color, everyone's going to know right away.
Yeah.
But this thing here, unless someone takes the time, this, all, of course, was developed by, it was thought of by a 14, a 13, and a 14-year-old. And they call their concept the STI. I think that's okay. They can,
like
an
investigator.
Yeah, and I think that they need someone to help them get a patent because it's going to sell. This was actually done in 2015. I don't know. I have to check and see where, what state this project is in. But the idea is, let's just take it, everyone's healthy. The idea is to protect pregnancy, is that the man wears the condom. Both of you do what you got to do. It's over. Okay. If, unless someone takes time to make sure that the condom has not ripped, you run the risk of being impregnated. It's just the way it goes.
That's always true.
That's true. This would be the same thing with a disease. So if he's wearing it, unless one of you take the time, and it should be him because he's wearing protection. He wants to know what's going on there. He wants to know what's going on during sex. Unless someone takes the time to see what's going on, and I don't know many 20-year-old guys, especially if they're a little bit drunk, that they're not going to do that. I'm a guy. Trust me. Guys don't do that.
The same ones that won't wear a condom, but the ones that would go and purchase this, I feel like they will. And I'm saying that this is something...
They will purchase this to see if it changed...
Guys don't even want to buy condoms at all.
That's true.
My rule is, if you don't have a condom, you need to go to the store. You need to get out of my house.
Yeah, that's true. But you, and you're absolutely right. But I assure you, they're not going to take this and look at it...
I wouldn't even put this on the guys. I mean, this is something that you should market to females.
Well, you can market the females to make sure that the guys wear it. Yeah. That would be a great idea. But really, it's only if a guy is wearing a condom, he's already got protection on, theoretically. The only way that this becomes, well, he'll find out right away. And if everything goes okay, the condom's in good shape, he takes, you know, everything is done, and now he sees it's a different color, and there's assigned colors for different diseases, then he'll know for the future, and he'll hope he's okay, and that'll be that. Everything worked out fine.
And even if they get it too late, at least they'll be aware of it then, and go to the clinic now. Like,
that's right.
Good. Like,
the only danger would come is if the rubber broke, and now he would know right away that something is up. He wouldn't wait to find out a few days later. Mm-hmm. That would be it, and that's it's just what it is. It's, you know, it's what it is. The students won about $1,500 in a trip to meet Prince Andrew at the time at Buckingham Palace. That was for their brilliant thing. Anyway, it is 9:51. I'm about done. I'm going to play one more song. Which song did you pull up that you'd like to close with? You want Rico? Okay. Okay, listen, before I go... I'm going to read one quick story. The headline alone will give it to you. This is from NPR. This came out just on the 28th yesterday. A man faints after getting a flu shot. He's okay. They take him to the hospital. He's okay. But he winds up with a $4,692 ER visit. That's what happened. He hadn't had a flu shot in 10 years. Took him to the hospital. Again, he woke up. He's fine. They checked him. Done. Send him home. $4,692 just because he had a reaction. Wow. Anyway, I just wanted to mention that. Also, there's a proposed law that would make animal cruelty a felony across the United States. That's still being, it's known as the Preventing Animal Cruel and Torture Act, okay, known as PACT. And is co-sponsored by Democrat Ted Deutch and Republican Vern Buchanan. I hope they pass that one. And before we play the last song, which we'll borrow a minute from the show, Just so you know, if you want, you can go on the web and you can name a cockroach after your ex for Valentine's Day, and it only costs $2. And that's all you got to know. You can Google that one yourself. I am going to sign out for now. I will see everybody next week, I think. And I'm going to leave you with, well, with all that's happening this week, with along with the Jules Holland Orchestra, this is Rico Rodriguez performing the Nat King Cole classic, Love. Have a good night, everybody. I'll see you next week.
Me, oh, is far the only one that I see. V is very, very extraordinary. E is even more than anyone that you adore can love. It's all that I can give to you, love.
To grow up safe and healthy. So we show them how, and we tell them, with honest conversations that let them know what we expect. That's especially important when it comes to alcohol and other drugs. Kids need to know the dangers and how to avoid them. And when it comes to pain medications, opioids, they need to know that they should never be taken without a prescription and never shared with friends or family. It's dangerous and illegal. So talk with your kids, because when you talk, they hear you.
Dinner?
Sure. I've been meaning to ask you, what would happen if someone offered you a drink?
Grandma!
If anyone ever does, I want you to say, no, I have too much respect for my family and I don't want to get in trouble.
I promise, Grandma.
They really do hear you. For tips on what to say, visit underagedrinking.samhsa.gov. That's underagedrinking.samhsa.gov. This message brought to you by SAMHSA and this station.
Yo, what's going on? Y'all listening to Skies Crescent Radio, and here's what's coming up. On the first Sunday of the month, we have the Poet Podcast with Dale Novella. On the second Sunday of the month, we have the Soul Tree Spotlight with Earlene Steven. And we also have Keeping It Funky with Troy Weeks. On the third Sunday of the month, we have Boozy News with Supreme Bars. And on the fourth Sunday of the month, we have What's Really Good with Jeanette Berry and Clout Dealers with the label Noir. And every Sunday at 7, we have Can We Not with Evan Combis. Peace.
It's hard to miss a day of work, but it's easy to spread influenza. Stay home if you get sick.